So, you've just found out you're having an ISO 14001 Environmental Management Systems audit. Congratulations on being selected, and don't panic. Don't worry, but let's get prepared. Having a certified management system helps demonstrate that you take environmental responsibilities seriously, and it provides confidence and assurance to your clients that you manage the project to a high standard. An audit is also an opportunity to learn and improve on what you are doing. Before the audit, check legal documents are in place and up to date. These might include waste carrier licenses and permits. If you are disposing of water, or if you are removing water from the ground, check there is a discharge consent and abstraction license in place. Check any consent conditions, which might mean you'll need to show evidence of testing. If there are any requirements to monitor noise, air quality or vibration, check the equipment is working and operated by competent personnel and that calibration records are available and valid. Make sure current versions of policies, documents and drawings are available. Mark any out-of-date documents as superseded. Make sure any drawings you are using are up to date. Look through the management plans and other relevant procedures before the audit. Make sure you understand the requirements. And if you have any doubts, ask someone for guidance. Check the risk register, also known as the aspects and impacts register. Inevitably, it is something they will focus on. Check the emergency plans. Do you and others know what to do in the event of a spillage or other incident occurring? We cannot be certain how the auditors will handle each visit, but it should follow roughly this format. They should have confirmed they will be visiting your project on a particular date or dates. They should introduce themselves and describe what they will do at the opening meeting. It's a good idea, the opening meeting, to tell them a little about the project they are auditing. But not so much as to delay the audit itself. They may want to tour the site and then look at procedures and management plans and ask questions based on these. They should end the visit with a summary of their findings. Any issues or non-conformances will be noted, and these may need to be addressed formally after the audit. In simple terms, they want to see that we have planned what we are doing what we planned, and have records to prove it. Look through the management plans and other relevant procedures before the audit. Make sure you understand the requirements. And if you have any doubts, ask someone for guidance. Check the risk register, also known as the aspects and impacts register. Inevitably, it is something they will focus on. Check the emergency plans. Do you and others know what to do in the event of a spillage or other incident occurring? Make sure there is a suitable room available, and make sure things are neat and tidy if you can. Remember, first impressions count. Auditors love to be nosy, and there is always a risk they might find something out of order if it's untidy or not organized. If the appearance of the offices give an impression of chaos, it will ring alarm bells in the auditor's mind. They may have their own PPE, but check beforehand. And also give a safety briefing when they arrive if appropriate. If possible, make sure key staff are available and attend the opening meeting. Ask about the auditor's lunch arrangements, and offer to provide a simple working lunch of sandwiches if appropriate. Try and avoid interruptions and phone calls during your discussions with the auditor. It doesn't matter who answers the questions, as long as they know what they're talking about. Even if someone says something out of turn, try to handle it diplomatically. If there is someone who cannot stop talking, they may not be the best person to front an audit. If a simple yes or no can be given, then do so. Beware of silence. Don't feel obliged to fill it. If a specific document is asked for, don't provide the whole folder or file. Show that you are in control. Agree in advance who will answer questions if you can. Do not argue amongst yourselves in front of the auditor. Think before you answer. There's no need to rush. Answer positively and concisely. Only answer the question asked and do not elaborate. If you don't understand the question you're being asked, seek clarification from the auditor. Only claim to do what you actually do. Remember, the auditor will ask you for evidence. And if the auditor asks for a document you know does not exist, just admit it. The auditors may raise a non-conformance or NCR, where you cannot demonstrate evidence, but they should tell you that they plan to do that. They can be major or minor. A major NCR is a significant finding, like not having a legal license you are required to have in place. They could also be multiple repeat failures observed on several sites. These will need to be closed out with a further visit, normally within 90 days. A minor NCR could be a breach of a requirement or lack of evidence of compliance. These will be closed out at the next scheduled audit. Observations may be raised where there is potential for non-conformance to occur if you don't take action. You don't need to formally respond to the auditor about observations. However, it is good practice to take action and close the issues out so they don't become more serious. Multiple observations of a similar nature seen on several sites or locations may be raised to a non-conformance in their final report. The auditor may review findings from previous audits, so it's a good idea to have a look at previous reports if you can. If you receive a non-conformance, it's not the end of the world, but a corrective action plan will be needed to help close out the audit finding. You can also use this as a learning opportunity and make effective changes to prevent the same problem happening again in future. A good corrective action plan will detail what the finding is, the corrective action to be taken as an immediate fix, identify the root causes and actions to be taken to prevent the issue recurring again. Root cause analysis could involve using tools like the 5 whys and fishbone analysis. See our other videos for more details on how these tools can help you.